Aviation Organization, a specialized agency of UN, as director for long years. Held a number of important positions, such as the chairman of Orissa Public Service Commission, chairman of Central Electricity Supply Utility of Orissa CESU. He was also the chairman of Regional Stock Exchange and chairman of Management Association affiliated to AIMA. He has also authored 4 books, 2 of which are Human Resource Management. He is an academician. He regularly writes in newspapers. Mr. Patnaik is a multifaceted, highly talented intellectual. Our next panelist is a career banker with more than 3.5 decades of huge experience in various aspects of commercial banking. He is Mr. Dinabandhu Mahapatra, the former MD and CEO of Bank of India. In addition to vast exposure in domestic banking, he has also exposure in international banking. He was director in Exim Bank, deputy chairman of Indian Banks Association, and chairman of Institute of Banking Personnel Selection. He was associated with National Institute of Bank Management as a board level member in various committees. As the executive director of Canara Bank, he was on the boards of Canara Bank's various subsidiaries. He has varied exposure in banking. He is a highly respected banker. We are also fortunate to have Dr. E. Shankar Rao amongst us. Currently, he is the MD and CEO of IFCI Limited, the fast development financial institution in the country. Dr. Rao, Stockholding Corporation of India Limited, SICI Venture Capital Fund Limited, IFCI Limited. He is also the chairman of 2 top-ranking academic institutes, namely Management Development Institute and Institute of Leadership Development. An alumnus of IIT Bombay as well as IIT Kharagpur, Dr. Rao is an academician and researcher, a trained technocrat, a respected financial specialist, and a prudent policymaker. He is deeply interested in academia and strongly believes in sharing of knowledge. Dr. Rao is a name to reckon with in the financial sector. Today's topic, that is Make in India, So Far, How Far. A brief on this, I would like to share. In his first independence speech on 15th August 2015, the manufacturers and investors from all over the world to come to India and make it in India. This declaration was formally launched as an ambitious program named Make in India on 25th September 2015. The major objectives of Make in India program were to increase the manufacturing sector's growth rate to 12-14% per annum in order to increase the sector's contribution to GDP to 25% by 2022 from 16% at that point of time, and also to create 100 million additional manufacturing jobs in the economy by 2022. Basically, the goal of Make in India program was to build India as a credible global manufacturing hub and make it an attractive destination for foreign investors from all over the world. To achieve this, trust was given on building a credible business environment with ease of doing business by eliminating various trade barriers and policies. The foreign investors were encouraged to take advantage of India's untapped manufacturing potential through direct investment. Nearly 6 years have passed since the launching of the program. For some time, the Indian economy has not been moving in the desired direction because of several macroeconomic reasons. Despite the turbulence, pandemic acted as a proverbial last straw. In financial year 1920, India's growth rate was reduced to 4.2% from 10% in financial year 2018. Recently, IMF has said that India's economy is projected to contract by 4.5% following a longer period of lockdown and slower recovery than anticipated in April. The IMF record reveals that which is the lowest ever for India in 1961. On the other hand, if we look at the progressively belligerent attitude of China in its territorial disputes with India, the most feasible explanation for this thing would be height of the phenomenon, which is more than 4 times of India's GDP. It now feels economically secure and military powerful, enough to pursue non-handling geopolitical ambitions. Had India been a $10 trillion economy, in all likelihood, China would not have fancied such an idea. Therefore, India's urgent need is to rebuild the economy and return to 7.5% growth trajectory so as to ensure that it matches up with China as well as possible. At this juncture, a review of the India program, which was intended to strengthen the economy, has become relevant. During the last 6 years, how it has happened and what course correction required, if any, how it is going to fit into the pumping in of 20 lakh crore rupees into the economy by the government, and how it is going to complement our claims called Bhopal for Local and thrust on Atmanirbhar Bharat need to be discussed. With this, I would request our learned panelist, Mr. Vivek Patnaik, to present an overview of the program over the years and its relevance. Please, Mr. Patnaik, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Patnaik, the coordinator of this webinar. And am I first audible? I want to know, am I audible? Well,
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Am I also visible or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, my intention is to make a presentation, a PowerPoint presentation, and I will request Professor Patnaik to actually move the slides, because I don't have the arrangements to make presentation from my computer. First, let me say, let me welcome all the participants. I am very happy that my co-panelists are two eminent people. One is Mr. Mahapatra, the former chief executive of the Bank of India, and then Dr. Rao, the present the chief executive of the IFCI. Well, in the first place, let me say, after the short introduction that was given by Professor Patnaik, I would like to mention that
PPT is ready for you.
Yes, it's okay. Can people see the presentation also on the screen? Their screens, are they?
Yes, sir.
You see, this program is a flagship program of the government of India. When the NDA government came to power, they launched the what we call is the Make in India program. Well, it covered actually 26 sectors. And the few sectors are automobile, electrical, electronic, defense, and biotechnology, chemicals and pharmaceuticals, mining, oil and gas. Also, it went to renewable energy. Aviation, roads, railway, ports, tourism and hospitality. And the next slide will show, I have given you the background, why this particular program was launched. And as very rightly was mentioned by Professor Patanayak.
Yes,
the objective of the program, of course, was to attract foreign and domestic investors to invest in the establishment of industries in India for exports, for import substitution, and domestic production, to make India a global manufacturing hub to generate employment. I would like to invite your attention that this was to see the manufacturing activities contribute more to the GDP of the country. Before 2014, its contribution was around 16%. The intention of the government prior to the present government was to take it to 25% of the GDP. Well, and most important thing was to generate employment. Now, if I take you to the next slide, Professor Patanayak, then I will try to say, can you take the next slide? Professor Patanayak, can you take the next slide? Yes. The background was the preceding years of low growth. There was a depreciation of rupee vis-a-vis US dollar, high oil price, falling investment, and many of you must remember the gloom of scams and what is was being called the policy paralysis. The 2G scam, the coal scam, 2G scam had ended up in cancellation of 122 licenses, which included also some foreign companies. And there was a stagnation in policy making. That was the generally felt in the media. The next is Mr. Professor Patnaik, you can go to the next one. Yes. Can you go to the next slide? Professor Patnaik. Hello. Am I audible? Okay. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
If you can produce the slide, it will be good. Otherwise, I can speak as it is. Is he in a position to produce a slide or no? No? Just give you 1 minute, let me open from my side. Can you open it, Professor Patnaik? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes. Now we are audible.
Yes, sir.
But yes. Well, you have now understood the background under which this program was launched. And interestingly, the investment climate of India was pretty good, because of course before that action that was taken was a comprehensive foreign direct investment policy, for the abolition of obsolete laws and regulations. As you know, the procedures were coming in the way. Then effort was made to improve procedures of ease of doing business. Then they organize conclaves and conferences and seminars and workshops. They visited various countries. And that is how the program started. Am I still audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I think Professor Mahapatra, you Amherst, but he says you are presenting to everyone. Stop presenting. Okay. Okay.
Next. PPT.
Next one.
Which one? Yes, sir.
This one. That's right. The various people went to various countries, and then to attract business people. The number of visits abroad. Then action by states, like the government of India, the states also started launching what they call the state government was the Making States program, like Making Odisha. And they organized similarly conclaves in state capitals, metros, and even went abroad. Display advertisements in local newspapers, the signing of MOUs in large number. The next slide will show. Next slide will show that the climate of economy at that time was excellent, in the sense there was consistent consecutive fall in global oil price from almost $120 per barrel to $30 per barrel, varying between $40 to $45 for a long stretch of time. And there was rekindling of confidence in new political leadership. And there were promises of reforms, effective decision making, and transparency. Okay? This was a favorable climate. Next. Let us try to make a review after 6 years. By 2019, economy had slowed down. Manufacturing activities had declined for many quarters. Power consumption also had come down. Power consumption is an indication of industrial activities. Exports showed downward trend. Import remained unabated. Increasing current account deficit. Rupee value vis-a-vis US dollar also started falling. Unemployment increased. Next slide. The state of financial institutions. Increasing non-performing assets among the PSU banks. The credit growth reached a very low level many years. Well, inquiries, investigations, media scrutiny, according to me, dampened the zeal and the spirit of the executives of the banks. Intervention by Bank Board Bureau to push credit. Newly constituted Bank Board Bureau, headed by the former Controller and Auditor General, tried to push. Then there was a new legal instrument which was brought in, involved Insolvency Banking Code, which is bankruptcy code, Insolvency Bankruptcy Code, which was in the pattern of the insolvency and bankruptcy law of the United States. Then, under this mechanism, efforts were made to reduce the NPS. Either the bankers will agree to take some haircut, or the entrepreneurs themselves will take some haircuts. That was one of the cause of delay, and nobody could take decision. Bankers were not willing to take tough decisions for obvious reasons. Then, non-banking financial companies and microfinance institutions were in not in happy state of affairs. And microfinance institutions have been actually limping for a long time. Then MSME, micro, small and medium industry, which contribute to exports, employment and GDP significant, struggle for credit in spite of a newly introduced scheme called Mudra for refinancing. Now let us go to the next. The next slide will show what are positive signs in the economy at the same time. Stock market remained vibrant. Sensex and Nifty at a high figure. Steady increase in foreign direct investment. There was a very impressive foreign institutional investment entry. Foreign exchange reserves also started growing. Now, next slide. Next slide, if you can go to the next slide. Yes. Achievements made in Make in India. I gave a picture, a background of the last 6 years, but at the same time, I gave the picture of what are the positive side and what are the negative side. Now, what are the achievements? If you read the websites of government of India, the news media and the articles, which are in plenty. In fact, I would suggest to the participant to go to the website of the government of India to have an idea. Auto industry, pharmaceutical industry, IT, computer, mobile phones, and startup. That's very, what do you call, spectacular achievements. Well, now next page, next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, Mr. Yeah. There is a need for analysis at this stage. How much of FDI contributed to greenfield projects? How much FDI has gone towards existing expansion and maintenance? How foreign institutional investment like pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, surplus of central banks, which are invested in Indian stock market, how far they have contributed to Make in India? This analysis is necessary to know what is the impact of the Make in India program, in spite of many things which I've explained, in spite of other things. And one thing is that there is dependence on imports, auto, electrical, electronic, and pharmaceutical. I will show you later how auto industry is dependent on imports, so also electrical, electronic, and pharmaceutical. The components and ingredients are imported. And of course, production takes place in India by way of assembly. But the basic components and ingredients are brought in from outside. So there is certainly Make in India in terms of assembly and a final product, but certainly not Make in India in terms of manufacture of basic components. Import from China was almost $72 billion. I would like to bring this to the notice of the participants. Recently, you must have seen in the Economic Times, a news item, that Adani Group is trying to set up world's largest solar power project in India. And it will start with some 8.8 gigawatt, and it will go to 15 gigawatt. But most of the panels, solar panels, will come from China. And in the background of this, I thought the post-Ladakh situation, there are boycotts, import restriction, there are reviews, scrutiny, and cancellation of MOUs. You have heard the news last night about some 50-odd Chinese applications in cancel. Now let us try to understand what the next stage. Can I see the next page? Mr. Professor, yes. Next page is, there was a disappointment. South Korean Behibat POSCO came in 2005. It wanted to set up a steel plant in Orissa based on iron ores of Orissa. And it remained till 2016. And by the time the Make in India program had been launched, it had manifested. But because of delay in land acquisition, environmental clearances, and allocation of mines, POSCO left in 2016. Then secondly, there were a lot of talk that multinational companies, because of high waste structure in China, they start relocating to India. And this is also in the news media after COVID-19. And but Nomura study of 2018-19 says that most of the 36 projects which came out of China went to Vietnam, Thailand, Philippines, Indonesia, even Bangladesh. Okay. Now, can we go to the next? I thought there was one a slide which I wanted to show you is probably missing. This is about Economic Times news item. It may be there later. I can see it can come. Which showed how much a dependence of which sector is on the Chinese imports for Make in India. Now, there is talk of self-reliant India. What does it mean? Does it mean no dependence on international supply chain for Make in India? Does it mean no import? Does it mean Make in India for the Indian market? Or can we really decouple from China now and immediately, if so, when? These are the questions which are in the mind. Can we go to the next slide, please? Yes, this is the one I wanted to show you, the slide. And if you can see it for yourself, dependence on our smartphones, which are manufactured, telecom equipment, television, home appliances, auto components, internet applications, which have been now cancelled. Then you see solar power, steel, and pharma. Imagine the quantum of dependence that we have. So these are hard realities you must remember. Next, these realities you must keep in view as your outlook for future. Make the Indian product competitive through cost reduction. Recently, there was an article published in the Economic Times written by Mr. R.C. Bhargava. R.C. Bhargava is the chairman of Suzuki. He was a civil servant. He is even senior to me by 10 years. I joined civil service in 1966. He joined in 56. He was associated with the establishment of Maruti from the very beginning. He is a very senior, seasoned civil servant with tremendous amount of experience. I would recommend that article came 2-3 days back, and if necessary, I'll send it to the ASBM copy of it, which they can share with participants.
Sure.
It's a very pragmatic article. Outlook for future. He suggests, naturally, I never really know, that Make in India must produce products which should be competitive. Not only for the whole world, there must be cost reduction, quality improvement, and timely supply. Invest for these things, there is a need for investment on research and development. Emphasis must be there at the academics on science, information technology, engineering, and mathematics. And there must be trust between the government and business and trade and commerce and industry. And one must not say that everybody who does business is always immoral. No, it's wrong. It's wrong. There must be a right skill and technical proficiency. There must be domain knowledge. response from the civil service should be prompt. And civil service must be responsive. There must be timely decision. And more important, hand-holding of MSME and startups. MSME is small enterprise, very small unit. Startups are equally small and set up by young people. They need a lot of hand-holding. And this is important, I thought I should say. Next, conclusions are, there should be clear vision, there should be sincerity, there must be commitment, focused approach, and there is no substitute to hard work. This is my presentation, and I can make presentation for now, but I know others have to make presentation. I do not want to make any conclusions at this stage, and these are the suggestions. Thank you very much, Professor Patnaik and other panelists for hearing. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir. You have very well brought out in the various facets of the program and issues involved in the implementation over the years. Thank you very much, sir. Now, banking provides sustenance to the economy of a country. Involvement of the banking sector, more particularly the public sector banks, is a sine qua non for success of any ambitious program like Make in India. Now, I would request our next panelist, Mr. Dinamandu Mahapatra, a thorough banker, to present us with a banker's perspective to the overall performance of the program. Mr. Mahapatra. Sir, your mic is mute. You can unmute it, sir. Sir, you are not audible. Your mic is muted. Sir, you are still not audible, sir.
Your mic is muted.
Your mic is muted, sir. Please.
You can call him over the phone.
Let's go out there. Sir.
Yes.
Sir, now that Mr. Mahapatra has gone out, and may I request Dr. Rao to fill in. Once he log in, then we can ask him to, once Mr. Dr. Rao finishes, then we can move on to, I think.
Hello.
Now he is.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Please go ahead, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Patnaik. And good afternoon to panelists Sri Vivek Patnaik and Sri Rao. And good afternoon to all the participants. I see some of the participants from overseas also. It's a good opportunity to interact with all of you. Mr. Vivek Patnaik has already explained in details. Let me just, before coming back to the role of banks, let me just cover the set the background. Background, you all know, India is emerging, and then we have to seize the opportunity. New government took place, and then they started something very ambitious. And the purpose, Dr. Patnaik also, he has explained, the purpose was very critical and very, you know, ambitious as well. There are four pillars. How to proceed? There are four pillars which are very, very important. The first pillar was new process. Ease of doing business, deregulate, de-license. The second pillar was a new infrastructure, that is creating industrial corridors, smart cities, and workforce development, skill development. And the fourth pillar was new sectors. They have identified 25 sectors and they focused on that. And the most important pillar was the new mindset. The new mindset is not easy to achieve. Be it banker, be it bureaucrat, be it industrialist, new mindset is something very, very difficult in Indian context. We are basically very innovative. We are basically very much risk-taking, but we are basically indisciplined. This new mindset, it takes time to ground. And the new mindset was accepting the change and going for rule-based and disciplined change. Then with that kind of four pillars, we started. We went for a great icon of lion, a moving, vibrant lion, and it started very well. Then what happened during the period? What steps we took to achieve our goal? We have done a lot many things. I'm just covering the aspect which is not covered by other speakers so that the participant can get some insight. What we did during this period, we did very good thing. We reduced corporate tax from 35% to 25%. We reduced the procedures for registering the new companies. We did all online. We went for modification in the direct tax code. We went for GST, which was pending for a long, long time. One country, one tax system. We started IBC, which was overdue, to address the banking issues and to help the emerging industrialists. We went for bank mergers to have a 5 trillion economy, and have that kind of muscles in banking. We merged many banks. We created behemoth. State Bank of India is among one of the 50th banks over the all over the world. And then other banks were also, they were merged and then created for taking this challenge. Also, we took many steps like JAM portal, where government wanted to encourage our own producers, manufacturers, so that class one, class two items are identified and country of origin was required to be mentioned so that our own things can be marketed, and many other things along with all these initiatives. Then progress, what we have done today, till today, though progress is not very, very encouraging, but it's not very bad as well. Taking the background of Indian democratic system, and any change, it takes time to to take wings. And we tried our level best. We achieved very, very little. If you see, the household saving came down during this 5-6 years time. Corporate savings little increased. Government capital formation, which is very much needed for any growth, particularly domestic growth, it declined from 28.6% to 28.6% from 31.3% from 14 to 19, as per the economic survey. And then manufacturing growth, instead of growing, it came down by 2-3%. And then even the most important segment of India's economy, that is agriculture, there also it was reduced. You may be knowing 50% of our GDP, most major portion of our GDP coming from agriculture, that also was not in a position to contribute. What went wrong? When we took the right initiative, we took the changes, many policy changes, what went wrong? If you see, it was very, very ambitious in view of Indian capabilities and Indian background. It was too ambitious, too many sectors focused, with little preparedness and with little arrangement to oversee and guide the development. In any country, when I was heading Singapore, I mean Southeast Asian country, Singapore is a very small country, but you know, they have outgrown the manufacturing sector, they have gone to knowledge sector now. This is a future and very different kind of potential they are present. There should be a team, a think tank team, a policy team, and an execution team. In Indian context, Niti Aayog, of course, it was there, but it's not the government-driven kind of arrangement. In India, we have so many states, so many political parties. All the stakeholders should believe the team, and team members should be drawn from different domain expertise areas, so they can really contribute. The team was not there. The policy think tank, right kind of policy think tank, right kind of membership. And the execution team, the IS officers, they have multiple things to do. And India is always prone to vagaries. And they have lot many challenges in lot many sectors. Everything they cannot, you know, take care in that, in the way we expect. There should have been a great team of execution, which should be independent of government interference and take all the stakeholders into consideration. For example, this COVID management, you see how many times state chief ministers were involved and how they are driving it as if it is their game. If you remember, when GST achieved, all the stakeholders, although they were different in their approach, but they are all taken into consideration and they drive the issue themselves. So that was lacking on our part. Of course, many other things, what I am talking about macro level, that was lacking. But today, we have also achieved whatever was not achieved during last so many years of our independence. Our index of ease of doing business has improved a lot. Our image in the in the world has gone up tremendously. Our government has taken huge initiative to forge relationships with the power that be. Now the government people also, they have given the mandate to the government for the second time. And fortunately or unfortunately, this COVID it will go definitely, it has its own round to finish and it will go away after some time. It has given a huge, huge opportunity for India to emerge as and next to none. Because the whole world is not very happy with the dragon economy. So dragon itself is facing, you know, kind of revolution, silent revolution in their own country. They have become themselves not that cost effective. India has got huge brand image today, and India has the highest young English speaking talented and, you know, hard working population in the world. The government is very much focused. When the entire sentiment is against dragon, the lion has to rule the jungle. It has come the time for the lion to seize this opportunity and re-emerge as one of the preferred nations for, you know, if you see, not that investment is not happening. Even our own people, they have invested more in outside country than in India. For example, Tata has invested in Koros. Tata has invested in Jaguar. That is because they find it more expedient to acquire knowledge, to acquire expertise, to acquire manpower, talent, and the cost effectiveness. They have themselves gone out. Our own, you know, capital has gone out for investment in outside countries. Whether we can create a conducive atmosphere, whether you can take all the stakeholders into account, in that context, bank definitely is going to play a big role. Today, if you see, I remember when I was young, you know, we were waiting wheat to come from US under PL 481. We didn't have wheat or rice to feed our own people. You know, the Green Revolution started by all the public sector banks and FCI, ICICI and IFCI. They supported huge infrastructure. And the PSU Bank led from the front. And the Green Revolution changed the situation. Now we are exporting food grains outside India. Similarly, the White Revolution, these banks made it possible. Today, anybody can travel from Delhi to Calcutta, Delhi to Chennai, 2,000 rupees. That is possible because of Indian banks, PSU banks. The entire infrastructure, of course, we have suffered, but then we have contributed for the national development. And we are born for that. And the banks always think that this mobile revolution, so happened because of the contributions by banks, PSU banks in particular. The Jan Dhan account, today we have 35 crores people, you know, linked to bank account. You know, in this time of pandemic, when people are very much disturbed, everybody got the support in his own account. That is possible because of bank. Today we have reached every nook and corner of the, you know, our country, and we are in a very good position to really support this huge ambitious project of Lion becoming the king of the world. And going forward, maybe the PSU banks will be requiring some capital, will be requiring the moral support. You know, a few months before, you might have heard that people talking about privatization of public sector banks. And they know what are the challenges, how the private banks are, you know, facing problems. That's not the answer. Answer is the commitment towards growth and development of the country. And PSU banks, the kind of mindset they have, that is quite unique. I have seen many countries, 45 countries, have not seen this kind of involvement of PSU banks, government banks for the developed country. Today, of course, they have challenges for capital provision, but I am quite sure they will find out some ways to support the growth capital for the PSU banks. And I am quite hopeful that whatever lessons we have learned during this journey from 2014 to 2020, we'll build on that and we'll refocus on these public sector banks and enable them to become the harbinger of change and ultimately let us wish that lion rules the world. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mahapatra. Thank you very much for your insightful deliberation on the program. You have not yet brought out the banker's perspective. You also touched upon various important issues like mindset and its importance. You also touched about various sectors like agriculture and all. Thank you very much. The main objective behind Make in India program was to strengthen the manufacturing sector and resultant creation of employment in the country. So how the manufacturing sector has fared by Make in India program, we cannot have a better authority than Dr. E.S. Rao to speak on this. Dr. Rao.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Pradeep Patnaik, and the Metco panelist, Sri Patnaik Saab, and then Mahapatra Saab. So I'll give you the perspective of what already Patnaik has given, and Mr. Mahapatra from the banking side has given. Now, yes, in 2014 we started with 25 sectors for the Make in India, and it's moving and some progress has been done. But the point which is now looked into, and then we have to redesign and reframe ourselves post-COVID, the situations are changing, the paradigms are changing, the normals are changing, and the way the things are going to happen will be completely different. So some kind of a changes have to happen. And our Honorable Prime Minister has mentioned there are 5 pillars which now we have to think about it. Environment, he spoke about economy, infrastructure, system, hybrid democracy, and demand. So on these 5 pillars, now we have to rebuild again and redesign the way we want to move forward. In that context, on the recent past, in the last, from the COVID, when it was started from February, March, the Government of India started giving some kind of a new narration and new guidelines and new system, so that you know the economy can kickstart and it can move forward. So that the motto is GDP growth of the economy and the employment, which is the bare necessity for the whole country and for the 130 plus people. Now, in that, first and foremost thing is, I come to the schemes which have been announced just 3 months back, and I have say got three of the schemes we are working right now for the Government of India, specifically in the electronics area. I'll come to that. But before that, as Professor Mahapatra has mentioned, the skill sets what we had earlier and now what we are going to have has to have some kind of a reimagining, re-engineering, and then we have to see that it's not dominated one. Demand also has to come, so the productivity will go up. That's my feeling. Technology has to be effectively utilized. In fact, now we are not moving. We have got to a new order of talking. We are not traveling at all. Nowadays, the seminars are happening virtually at no cost. So the situations have changed. The technology is helping us to connect together. Similarly, at the same time, whatever we do in manufacturing or in infrastructure, the quality and standards are very important to compete. But we cannot sustain it all, because the rejections will be there, no one will accept your products. So if you have to be dominant role and be in the top 3 economy, your production and making Indian quality and standards have to be there. So this is the prime thing which you have to keep it from after what Prime Minister has mentioned, 5 pillars what he has mentioned, on that skill set. Now this is the base. Now on that we can talk in terms of what are the schemes. Now recent schemes which Government of India announced is on the electronics. Now, electronics PLI is one of the scheme. I don't want to get into the details. You can go to the websites and see. PLI specification spec is another one, and MCP. MCP is for 10,000 crores incentives already. Nearly 5,000 has been given. Now, to extend more support and bring investments and FDI into the country, the PLI has been launched. It was inaugurated only 15 days back by the minister. Now, all the mobiles, second number in the world, mobiles will be manufactured now in India, across the country, in various states. And for that, incentives will be given as the PLI scheme of the Government of India. and IFAI is the monitoring agency and project manager for that scheme. Similarly, another one for components, when you make a system, a computer system or a telephone components, that is known as specifications components scheme at CAMP. That scheme also IFAI got as a project manager. We are going to project management consultant. So we monitor and then these investments in components making happen. With these schemes, roughly around 30 lakh people will get new jobs will be created. And then so much of digital products are made in India and it can be exported. So this is one area which is there. Based on that, similarly, pharma also for Ministry of Chemicals and from the Department of Pharmacy, Government of India, they launched their own schemes for three clusters of medical clusters they want where medical devices can be manufactured. Similarly, four clusters for making the pharmacy, pharma chemicals, pharma and other chemicals to be manufactured in four clusters in four states. That process is going on. So these are the things which are come post-COVID, because these are the things, not digital age is going to be there in every aspect of business. So now already we are seeing that through the webinar. Similarly, infrastructure is important so that more manufacturing can happen. Manufacturing, I can say, suppose if you want more option, more power, generators have to be developed, transformers have to be developed, switching gears have to be, wires are required, cables are required. Similarly, if a telecom is there, you need telecommunication equipment, switching equipment, transmission equipment, instruments, software. So manufacturing will add to the infrastructure. So infrastructure, if you make it as a center, so national infrastructure pipeline, which was announced by the Honorable Finance Minister only 1.5 months back. Now these 33 subsectors, if they grow, then more manufacturing equipment also will come in, and the products and services will become cheaper and qualitative for the common man. Because you need electricity, you need telephone, you need traveling of air travel, you need ship travel, you need water, you need the sanitation. So these are all infrastructure, which will show more cement, more steel. You know, these are the requirements which will be coming. So 111 lakh crores of this particular infrastructure pipeline has been launched for next 5 years. So this electronic schemes for manufacturing, national infrastructure projects one of infrastructure, if it happens, these will augment for the $5 trillion what the Honorable Prime Minister is actually looking for. Now, I give you post-COVID, which are the things which are, you cannot put all your money into the sectors which cannot grow. Now you have to put the money in the sectors which will grow. Because post-COVID, the sectors are changing. Now, important thing is, now more and more you'll have electronic devices for connecting to the refrigerator, connecting to the power plant, you can control from it. That is known as IoT devices, Internet of Things. So this will happen only because we have now 4G, we have 5G, we are going to get it in next 2 years. Now 4G is more than sufficient to run these IoT devices. Now from here I can operate even my webcam in Bombay, my house, I can see US come and US not come. From here I can see every day and monitor. So security system, your control of your refrigerator. So IoT devices will come. That is one area which is going to be big, this one. And for all this, you need electronic waves. That is your telecommunication network, fiber network. So these two, if it is made, then your things will become much more easy. E-learning, e-teaching, e-health services, these are all going to happen live. And you require live on real-time basis. So you need a huge bandwidth for all these things. So as if it is, he's standing next to you. Similarly, mechatronics. Now, automobile cars are all controlled today by electronics only. No more than mechanical one. They are only the prime passive item. But it's become more intelligent. So mechatronics is going to come in place. Defense, order of the day, which is needed with the way that things are happening. So a lot of defense production will also get into action. Similarly, agri and food. Post-COVID, what is important people realize is food. So now you will have seen that more food processing and food agriculture related clusters will come. Similarly, electrical vehicles will come. Now oil imports have to be minimized because this is going to be a killer on our CAD and then on our fiscal deficit. So electric vehicles, battery manufacturing, solar chips which are going to be made so that you can make the panels. Now the chips are coming, but panels are integrated. So you have to change the way you want. But for that, you need quality, skill network, skill development. Then only you can do all these things. Similarly, entertainment business is going to grow in a big way. Today, the biggest thing after post-COVID, people have started seeing movies and everything, entertainment at home. the days are going to change about the cinema also. So entertainment is going to be the major one, and similarly the media is going to be completely digital. Similarly, for doing big business, and then the models are undergoing change, a lot of competition is there. Data analytics will come into the picture today. Data analytics, deep machine learning, and an artificial intelligence. So these have to be built on the fundamentals for the 5 pillars of practice, what you mentioned, schemes which will be from various ministries, manufacturing, then infrastructure, so that you know the whole GDP on infrastructure and services, manufacturing and industry, agriculture and food processing. These three will components will go proportionately between the rural areas, urban areas, and in the city, so that the migration of people can be minimized. So there is huge opportunity for making India either as a startup or as a new venture by the industrialists, or the expansion of this particular one. And we have enough of things. Think not only for domestic, we have domestic demand, but we're thinking about exports. The way when we do for the exports, your quality will come up, your prices will come down, volumes will go up. So there is huge opportunity in the next 5 years if the policies and regulations are conducive for the investors to come, or for the entrepreneur to start, or a new startup to start. I think you do well. At the same time, what central government is doing, most of the other state governments also has to do it to become more proactive. If that happens, and with the proper continuous upgrading of skill set, I think we have a golden area for the next 5 years. So this is where exactly I feel the opportunities which are there for making India. So far what we have and the way ahead for us, what we have. Thank you. Professor Patnaik.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. Thank you for your very well described speech on various sectors that you have touched upon. Improve their performance under this Make in India program. You have touched upon them very well. Thank you very much. So now that we have listened to the speeches of all our eminent analysts, if there is any question for any participant, we have to go for that. But till now, we have not received any question from any panelist in the chat box. So, that we also have already reached our time limit, and there is hardly any question from any of the panelists. I will take this opportunity on behalf of ASEAN University. I thank our esteemed panelists. I thank all the participants. Also, request them to send their feedback for our betterment. I also thank Professor Vishwajit Patnaik, President of ASBM, and Professor Kalyan Sankar Rai, Vice Chancellor of ASBM University, for their active involvement in the webinar. I also thank the technical team and other faculty members of ASBM University to make the webinar a successful one. Thank you, Dr. Rao, thank you, Mr. Patnaik, and thank you, Mr. Mahapatra. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.